sent the flintstones flying, but the pony kept his feet. He cleared the fallen timber in his stride, and the man from Snowy River never shifted in his seat. It was grand to see that mountain horseman ride. Through the stringy barks and saplings on the rough and broken ground, down the hillside at a racing pace he went, and he never drew the bridle till he landed safe and sound at the bottom of that terrible descent. Small town in the mountains of north central Victoria, quiet, perhaps even sleepy. But be that as it may, the horse and the history of this town are forever linked. A man who has taken an intense interest in the colourful history of the Omeo district and who himself has chased the wild horses is Mervyn Pearson.
For over 100 years, horses have played a major part in the development of Australia. In fact, settlement would have not have been possible without them. The first English thoroughbreds to arrive in this district arrived about 1848. They were imported by Mr. Crook, the original owner of Hennemungee Station. These horses were bred as remounts for the Indian cavalry. They were shipped from Port Albert direct to India. Apparently, some of these early station horses strayed into the bush very early in the piece, because some of our earlier stockmen were known buckrunners. Among them was Harry Faithful, Joe Rawson, and Johnny Riley. Johnny Riley was born in Ireland. He arrived in Omeo at an early age and learnt his horsemanship here. Later life, he moved over to the Upper Murray in the Jindabyne districts. There, as a rider, to become immortalised in Banjo's Patterson poem, The Man from Snowy River.
He was a small man, slim, straight, erect, smart, athletic bushman.
Some pioneers still remember the man from Snowy River. Togo Pentagast.
I knew Johnny Riley. Johnny Riley used to stay here in this old house. On his way from Tom Grogan, 40 miles away, to visit his old sister at Omeo. We had a lot of chats around the fire and the big fireplace. And old Riley did see, I remember that, he'd say. He had a hut, it was a one-roomed affair. The door and the window, and the table, and a bunk, a couple of bunks, I think. And his old dog would sit outside, not like this fellow would, you know.
The original bucks were not numerous. They were horses strayed from the station. Later, when free selectors took over most of the station properties, some of them continued to breed horses for the Indian market. Naturally, some of these horses strayed into the bush and joined the wild horses. Hence, the origination of the Bogong bucks. Now, between Brunambra and New South Wales border, probably 1,000 horses run, spread over a couple of million acres of rugged country. These horses have now become inbred and are of very little commercial value. But the local boys make odd trips into the bush and run down a few of the outlaws to supplement buck jumpers required for their annual Easter rodeo.
Buck running is regarded by these men as weekend fun. They meet at the Hilltop Hotel and discuss their plans for the latest run.
Anyway, we're right on the saddle. Good. Jim, you got the yards there. And, you go out the other way, you haven't got the decent yards. You get back there, like you've got to lead the bucks back there just to get them bloody yards.
I reckon most of the planes will go.
Oh, yeah.
You blokes be able to laugh at me because I'll probably get tossed off.
Billy, run them in off the plane. She's damn good. Are you going to stop in the plane with me or are you going to have most trouble? Riding the brumbies?
No.
Probably leave about 2 or 3 o'clock.
Anyway, Bill, I'll
see. Am I the bloody machine? Can you, how many horses can you chew a day?
You
shouldn't have. That's
fine, yeah. All the best.
You aren't picking up at all, you pick you up. A few years ago, having left the hotel, the Buckrunners would have taken everything by pack horse from Omeo to the Bogong High Plains to track down the elusive brumby. But, as with so many other things, the machine has taken over to a certain extent, and they now take as many supplies as possible by four-wheel drive vehicle. Their saddle horses still have to be led up to the camp, and even late in the evening, horses are still arriving.
Hook him up.
The following morning, the camp rises early to get on with the day's run. After a quick breakfast, equipment is checked because a broken girth or stirrup leather or a loose shoe in this rough country can mean serious injury. One of the key men is Jim Flanagan, who explains how a buck run is planned.
Well, it's making the plans, I suppose. The usual thing of a morning, a couple of boys will be asked to quietly ride round a certain ridge to come in behind the mob of horses we hope are there. The rest of the boys, we usually go up to the yard, check them, make sure all the gates on the opposite end are secure. Then we go out and we form our wing. And
when you talk about forming a wing, what do you mean?
Well, just forming a wing, you've got to bring the horse into a type of a funnel so they'll come into the yard. And as you go out, well, sometimes we have the wings built up with timber and so on, and then you'll go out and you'll leave a man off. He's well planted behind the scrub. You go along a bit further and you see a nice little sheltered corner and a bit of a track leading down, so you put another man there. Now, the idea of that is that when these horses come down, there's a track leading off and they've been stirred up, they'll poke off down that. So that fella, then he comes out and gives them a bit of a start. Down they go back down the main track, but he just keeps along working them in. and he continues on to the man's down from him, and he continues them on in. These men on the wings, I suppose, on each side, there could be ending up to 10 or 12 men. And then they might have to have that wing about three parts of a mile long. By the time you get these men organised on the end of the wing, you've only got a few minutes left to be nice and quiet. So the three boys that have been sent out first have just about got those horses lined up, then they'll start them up and bring them in. They'll possibly crack a whip and a few hoys and calls and one thing or another, so that they know there's action coming. And they're really on their toes. They're waiting, watching, and listening. And the mob comes along, and he slips out nicely, gives them a fright, stirs them further down that track. He goes on down, and there's Pat. Righto, take over, Pat. Pat takes over, and he keeps him working, and he gets a bit further down, and Mick's waiting. So he gives Mick the call, keep him in, Mick, keep him in, they're getting out a bit. And Mick roars and bellows and shouts his head off. And he turns them back in, and then there's a big thrust towards the finish of it. You see all these boys converging in, and we usually hope there's about 20 at least horses going into this funnel up into that yard. And there's a big cloud of dust and boys pulling up horses and saying, look at them, look at them, these are beauties, we'll have some fun at this rodeo. And sometimes that doesn't work like that.
I don't like the sound of this whole thing.
Hey, Bruce, before you go and put the reins over head, though.
Well, I'll get on.
Well, get on to one of you fellas and give her a rip round the flat. Go on, Ken.
Right on, you young fellas.
Jenny, get on her.
Give her a bit of a derby up for him. Go on.
I'll get you, Ken. Paddy's
right. Yeah, look after me,
Jenny. How do we get her? Well, she might dump that to the
bog, Ken. She dumped up me, eh?
Kenny kindly goes in the bog.
What's been on this bloody jockey? Was she back or not?
Give her a bit of steel, ain't you?
Give it
up. Hold on. <that. laughs>
Final instructions are given by Rodeo President Charlie Flanagan.
Haven't been up here before. And when you put on a wing, or in the position, I want you to keep that position, look after it. Keep quiet, don't make a noise, keep your horse out of sight. Only come out when you're supposed to come out. You know a bit about running horses, and you know when to come out. Don't get in the road of the horses coming through. If they're coming through on the right track, leave them come. If you want to turn them at the right time. But the main thing is to keep quiet, not make a noise. If they see you, if you make a noise in this country, they can hear you for miles. Now, don't be singing out to one another, or here they come, or something else, just as the other chap will know when they come. So don't forget that.
Main thing, not leave position, Charles.
That's right, and the main thing is to be on your horse and ready to go at a minute's notice. You don't get much.
Give him a bit of a yahoo as they go past, drive by the next man, though.
Yeah, that's right.
Follow him on to the next man, and then you go back to where you were.
You put a bloke in a position, no good him walking, riding down to see his mate, to have a yarn to him.
Now, supposed to be in that position some dark, if necessary.
That's right.
Now, Billy and Jimmy and Mick, they're taking the team down this to the Rocky Plain. Now they'll pick their men out. The other men can go up with Joe up to the yards, and he'll
place up there. We can all go up, Charlie, and ride down.
Well, Joe'll place them men along the wing. That's all, boys. Good luck to you.
Probably need it too.
Yeah.
Stick with her, parents. Stick with her.
Get in there, Noah!
Get him.
The brumbies can be heard by the saddle horses well before their riders, for some of the horses are broken brumbies themselves. And a final hint that they are nearby is given by a lift of the head and the pricking of the ears. So they are yarded, the pride of the stud, by virtue of breeding, a triumph of blood, the browns and the blacks where some mare of the strain has thrown a colt to the colour again of the gallant old stallion whose paces were known wherever great horses in harness were shown. And here there's a filly, a fine little bay, from her head to her heel she's a winner, they say, while down by the stalls there's a Saracen colt, his mother was one of the breed of revolt. And what of his future? It's 2-1 on. He'll go to the south where his brothers have gone.
Watch out! Watch out! The day has not been easy, and after several runs, man and horse are ready to relax, and of course, healthy appetites must be catered for.
Are you feeling it? See you? Not on my own.
After a big meal with good company, what better than a few cans and a song?
I'll be thinking of you howling round the pine as I'm riding across the great divide. And every time I swing my lariat, it brings me back to someone I can't forget. There's a long knot in the lariat, and it's waiting for my little gal, you bet. Now when I swing my old lassie, you keep my ankle of course. Oh, there's a long knot in my lariat, and the ankle of up the track, heading for the stockyard in the hills, and the outback bush is ringing with the songs I love to sing. I'm riding with the boys among the hills. I hear a happy bunch of stockmen bred on the open plain, born to fork a saddle and a brush of brumby's mane. Oh, with fancy boots and stock whips, we're out for a darn day's fun, and every Saturday morning finds us out on the run. Holy.
However, this cannot go on too long, as each man has his job for the morning. More bucks must be sought, so by late evening, each man is in his bedroll. With the weekend drawing to a close, the bucks must be taken from the high plains. Not an easy task when a horse that has been running free suddenly has his freedom taken away. A host of young horses, high-fettled with fun, satin coats catching the glance of the sun, puzzled lips picking the hard-bitten rails, tender feet treading the pad of new trails, and wistful eyes watching the shadows that run away to the west in the wake of the sun. The paddocks, their prison, their home was the plain. Their kindly companions, the wind and the rain, that together at even to exiles will bring a breath of the hilltop, the bird on the wing, and a memory of pastures imprinted with pain on hearts that will never know freedom again.
Where the birds are singing gaily in the stately blue gum trees, and the scent of blooming wattle floats all the evening breeze. Blowing off stray cattle beside a running stream, the stockman's whips are cracking, it lingers like a dream. 'Cause we're a happy bunch of stockmen, bred on the open plain, born to fork a saddle and a brush of brumby's mane. Oh, with fancy boots and stock whips, we're out for a darn day's fun, and every Saturday morning finds us out on the run. Oh, today, do 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 do.